Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to all of you. Glad to see you all here. Still have a bit of capacities, but who knows, that might just fill up as we get started. Today's session is on regional economic integration and trade facilitation in the case of ECOWAS, and I will introduce the panelists to you in a second. We have heard a lot in the past 2 days of the Trade Development Symposium, but also obviously before that, about plurilaterals, regional and multilateral agreements, and how they're entwined. And this session is due to explore a case at hand, the ECOWAS case, and its member states, and the various actors involved there, on how the relationship between regional economic integration and a multilateral agreement, in this case the Trade Facilitation Agreement, how they actually play out together. We want to discuss with our distinguished panelists how actors on regional and national level can jointly move forward to actually facilitate access to regional and global value chains and to markets, how governments, private sector, and donors can and need to come together to foster regional integration for sizable markets and a strengthened voice, but also to harmonize rules and regulations, to reduce costs for trading and to boost intra-regional trade. And to do that, I'd like to introduce our speakers. First, we have Ms. Assome Diatta. She's the Director of External Trade from the Ministry of Trade in Senegal. She has been there not so long yet, but she has been in the ministry for quite some time, and she's been in the topic for quite some time. She's been an advisor on commerce to two various different prime ministers. She's been heading the trade department in the Fatick region in Senegal. She holds a degree in business law, and we look very much forward to hearing your views and insights from your country's case in a bit. Then I have to my right, or to the in the middle of my right, actually, Mr. Yunusa Labaran. He's the Director of Trade in the Nigerian Ministry of Trade and Investment. And he's also the coordinator of the Growth and Employment Project in Nigeria, which I think is, has received quite a wide media coverage and a lot of attention. Before, he was the Deputy Director of WTO Affairs and was involved in multilateral trade division in the Ministry of Commerce. He's negotiated many trade agreements extensively, as far as I've learned, so I think his insights will be very insightful for all of us. He holds a degree in economics, and we look very much forward to hearing from you in a bit. To my immediate left, we have Mr. Kola Safala. He's within the ECOWAS Commission, the Principal Program Officer for Multilateral Trade, responsible for negotiating international trade agreements. Previously, he worked in the Ghana Ministry of Private Sector Development and Trade, also there as an expert for ECOWAS. And he's also spent several years in the private sector. And he holds a degree in development economics and is a chartered management accountant. And I think all of that put together, we will be very curious to hear your insights later on. To my immediate right is Mr. Tiller. He's the Deputy Director General of Global Cooperation within the Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development in Germany. He has held different positions within BMZ. Among others, he was the Deputy Director General for Asia. And also, which is interesting for me, because I work for GIZ, so I forgot to introduce myself, was on a professional leave, seconded to GIZ as a Director General for Migration, and also a member of the executive committee within GIZ there. Mr. Ziller holds a degree in law, and he will give us some insights on the position of the German ministry in a while. And on the far right, we have Dr. Vita Schmieck. She's a research fellow at the German Institute for International and Security Affairs, and her focus areas are trade, regional integration, and development issues. Prior to that, she was Head of Division on Globalization within BMZ. So she also has different perspectives she can bring into the picture. She holds a PhD in economics and has recently done some interesting research on regional integration, which she will share with us during this panel as well. Without further ado, And maybe to start us off with a quote from Madame Fatima Asil, which I found very inspiring on Monday. She said, "We in Africa have no choice but to integrate, and we must work on trade facilitation." So perhaps this is a star to put our discussion underneath. And I would like to head off and with a round of introductory statements by all panelists, which we will do initially. We have a keynote from Ms. Evita Schmieck at the end of that, and then we will enter a discussion on the panel. And as time allows, I would then also like to open the floor for questions and answers with all of you. And to head us off on the panel, Madame Diatta.
It's a pleasure for me to be here sharing this panel with all of you. And I would like to thank organizers, particularly ECOWAS, which is very concerned by improving the trade between the countries' members. And I am sure that trade facilitation can help us to do more. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this symposium. First and foremost, let me thank the organizers for this event. As a Nigerian, I think, let me say from the perspective of Nigeria on TTF, I think even before the TF agreement was concluded in Bali, Nigeria underscored the importance of TF agreement, particularly how it can reduce the cost of doing business. We flag up what is called the Trade Facilitation Task Force that was set up in 2010. Even before the TF agreement was signed. So my expectation at this event, that at the end of the day, we should agree on how at regional and national level, the TF can be, processes can be harmonized with a view to reaping the benefits that an agreement such as trade facilitation could give to a common man. Thank you.
Thank you and good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure for the ECOWAS Commission to participate at this event. We'd like to thank our partners, ICTSD, as well as the Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development. It is indeed a pleasure for ECOWAS to participate here, and I bring greetings from the Commissioner of Trade and the President of the Commission. And I am here as well to represent the Director of Trade, who is unavoidably absent. I would just like to start off with perhaps a bit of a background to ECOWAS, to those of us who are not familiar. Although I do see many familiar faces, I see colleagues from Cape Verde, from Nigeria, and other West African states. But for those who are not so familiar, ECOWAS was established in 1975 as part of the Treaty of Lagos. And 1975 to date, we're actually celebrating 40 years of our existence this year. ECOWAS is one of the pillars of the African Union, and we're made up of 15 member states. We have three official languages, French, English, and Portuguese, and our various countries are either landlocked, island countries, or coastal economies. So we have certain specificities to ensure that we can address the needs of our particular member states. The region in total has a population of approximately 350 million people, with a combined nominal GDP of about $750 billion. It was one of the fastest growing regions in 2013, with a growth rate of about 6%. ECOWAS has a vision, Vision 2020, which talks about creation of a borderless region where citizens can live in peace and in security. And we aim to move from an ECOWAS of states, of institutions, to an ECOWAS of people. ECOWAS itself, at the highest level, is represented by the heads of states and government of the 15 member states, and there are a number of institutions that manage the operations of ECOWAS. I'm from the ECOWAS Commission, but we also have the ECOWAS Courts of Justice and the ECOWAS Parliament. So that's just a bit of a background to what the structure of ECOWAS. I'm from one of the arms of ECOWAS. And I look forward to our contribution and the discussion on trade facilitation, which we believe is important to deepening our regional integration. So once again, thank you very much, and I look forward to our deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kola. Mr. Tiller.
Thank you. Yes, I'm very pleased to be here, to be on this panel among so many distinguished colleagues. And I would like to welcome you all on behalf of the German government to this symposium, and to thank ICTSD for so kindly helping us to organize this event today. About a year ago, end of 2014, when 2015 was upcoming, we all thought of 2015 as the year of development and the year of sustainable development. And we have made a lot of progress over this year, I think. We have come to good results in Addis, in New York, and now finally also in Paris on the climate agenda. But specifically in Addis and in New York, we have emphasized how important it is for this sustainable development which we are envisaging to promote a fair, inclusive, and sustainable multilateral trade system. And this can only be interpreted as a dramatic appeal to those negotiating now at this conference here in Nairobi to also do their share and finally make progress on this very cumbersome trade agenda. And while probably the whole Bali round might be very complicated and not an issue very easy to solve, it's important to make progress on the issues where you can make progress. And I think the trade facilitation agreement is something which is very important in this context and where we can make progress. We already have made quite some progress when we've managed to globally decrease the tariffs on manufactured goods from somewhere around 40% to somewhere around 4%, also through successful multilateral efforts. But now we have to also tackle the non-tariff trade barriers, because it's now these non-tariff trade barriers that lead to high trade costs and that are reducing the positive effects also of the increased regional integration that we are seeing overall, but also especially in LDCs and in the landlocked countries. And both LDCs as well as landlocked countries were very much highlighted in the discussions in the Addis process and also in the New York process as some of the country groups which we have to specifically support in this sustainable development agenda. So it's our task to reduce these non-tariff trade barriers, and the trade facilitation agreements implementation will go a long way in enabling especially LDCs but also other developing countries to benefit from the positive effects of a deeper integration, such as economic growth, increased welfare and employment. But to really reap these benefits, we need to turn rhetoric into action and thus to focus on rapid implementation. And today's event here is especially important to me because we'll also talk about the regional angle and the interlinkage between regional integration and trade facilitation. And taking the ECOWAS region as an example, I think is a quite interesting thing, because that's also an area where we have been quite active in the past in order to facilitate this regional integration and especially to facilitate regional integration in the area of trade and trade facilitation. So I'm very keen on the outcome of today's discussions. Hope that I can contribute a bit, and now I hand back to the moderator. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tiller. Evita, I hand over to you to give us some in-depth insights, and yes, please take it away.
I'm very happy to be here and grateful to be able to participate in this interesting discussion. And I try to give you a little bit an overview on basically four issues. First, I will be short because I think most of you are very familiar with this topic, is what are the obstacles to trade in the ECOWAS region? Second point will be the importance of trade and of reducing trade costs. Third point is the interlinkage between trade and value chains. And my fourth point will be three policy conclusions. So the figures, just as a background, cost of trade procedures, what are the obstacles to trade in the ECOWAS region? The cost of trade procedures are very high in the ECOWAS regions, but there is a big difference between member states. ECOWAS ranks quite low in most of the doing business indicators that, that the World Bank is collecting. I give you just one example. The number of documents to export is 7 in ECOWAS, whereas in the best country, that is Ireland, it's 2. The time to export a product in ECOWAS, it takes 26 days. In the best country, that are different economies, it's only 6 days. But the countries in, within ECOWAS do perform quite differently. For example, Senegal is doing much better. With the time, with regard to the time to export, it's 12 days. You don't need to remember these figures, but I think it's just interesting as a background to be aware of what we're talking about. The problem is that time-consuming procedures not only reduce trade volumes, but they do reduce the probability that firms will enter into export markets for time-sensitive products from the start. So they are really also an established barrier for entering into operation. And that is a point that might especially hamper agricultural exports. Cost of transport infrastructure also are especially high within the region. And the worst thing is that even the costs of trading intra-regionally in Western Africa are even higher. They are 3 times the equivalent cost of shipping with the external region. So that means to trade between ECOWAS countries, it's even much more expensive than to trade outside. Shipping a container to the EU is easier than transporting it across a land border to a neighboring country. Then additional burden comes from long waits and charges at intra-ECOWAS borders, and partly even arbitrary charges. ECOWAS and IMOA have given special attention to integration road, to integrate road transfer in the sub-region and to improve the West African road network, because they realize that this is, of course, a basic problem to regional integration. Now, how much can be gained through trade facilitation? The OECD assesses that the potential to reduce trade costs through comprehensive trade facilitation reform in sub-Saharan Africa would be 17%. And this potential is much higher than for other regions because the costs are much higher than they are in other regions. So my second chapter, or the second point I want to speak about, is the importance of trade and reducing trade costs within ECOWAS. Trade is very important for most of the sub-Saharan African economies. External trade makes up the bulk of especially sub-Saharan economies, with some countries where the share of external trade in GDP is even more than 80%. Ghana is such an example. The share of regional trade did not really change during the last decade. It is about 10%. But this figure hides big differences within the region. Nigeria is a large country concentrated very much on the production of oil and products linked to that, is less linked with the regional market, whereas other countries are much more, trading much more intra-regionally. For example, Ghana, intra-regional trade share is about 20%. But for Burkina Faso, it's even more than 70%. I said that the share is not very high, with 10%, but that at least this kept pace with the fast overall trade expansion. Trade expanded within, trade more than quadrupled in ECOWAS, or from ECOWAS, since 2000, and regional trade did keep at least its share of 10%. That means it also quadrupled. But what is very important is the composition of trade, of regional trade in comparison to global trade. And that is very different for most ECOWAS member states. But overall, the share of manufactured goods is much higher in regional trade than it is in the exports to other countries, to other regions. The share of manufactured goods in regional trade is 30%, about 30%. For example, the share of manufactured goods it exports to the EU is about 3%. And this is a very important point because it's manufactured goods, basically, that contribute to value added. So that is very, that makes a very important point. I want you to keep in mind, because this plays a very big role with regard to the policies that we want to design with regard to trade as an instrument to support development. So the reduction of trade costs would facilitate trade within the region, and the assumption is that it would also have an impact, a direct impact, on a country's ability to integrate in global value chains. Now let us come to trade and global value chains. Of course, trade is not an end in itself. What we want to do is to contribute to sustainable development. Therefore, it's very important to know or to see and to realize how far can trade help to create value added and to support the creation of decent jobs. And with regard to this point, it's very important that the share of manufacturers in the regional trade is much higher than it is in external trade. So with globalization, since the end of the 1990s, new possibilities emerged for developing countries to integrate into global value chains. Production is today fragmented across borders, and countries can take over small steps of global value chains, and that lowers the need to invest in large production sites up front. That is, it's easier now to participate in global production and to produce for export. But the bad news is that competition, of course, intensified at the same time. Mr. Ziller already pointed out that the average tariff today is very low. It's below 10%. And the bulk of trade costs depends on other issues. And that's issues like sanitary and phytosanitary standards, the costs of inputs into production, transport costs, which are very high, especially in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, and other trade facilitation issues. So overall, the issue of competitiveness has become much more complicated. And there we are in the middle of the discussion about trade facilitation. But it deserves a closer look on what that means for individual countries and regions, and especially for the issue of sustainable development. The integration of a country or region in international value chains is, however, to a large extent determined by factors that cannot be changed in the short term. Country-based specific characteristics are very important, like size and geographical location, as well as the share of manufacturing in GDP. So for sub-Saharan Africa, that means that from the start, the prospects for integrating into global value chains are not so good, because there is the remoteness, which is expressed by lack of and poor quality infrastructure, and that is a very critical factor that impedes further participation in global value chains. Additionally, the existing trade structure neither is a good starting point. For 15 countries in sub-Saharan Africa, one or two commodities make up more than 75% of their exports. So they are still very much dependent on commodities for a contribution to exports and GDP. Africa's share in world trade decreased from around 6% in 1980 to less than 2% in 1989, and it has remained low since then. And the second factor, which is important with regard to the issue of integrating into value chains, is that most African countries still rely heavily on agriculture. The industrial sector's share of employment is only 9%. And family farming is the largest source of employment. With regard to the possible contribution of the economies in global value chains, the large discrepancies between cities and the remote rural areas are very important. It is, of course, possible to strengthen international linkages, mostly with urban coastal areas and areas which are well linked to international production. But this should not go at the expense of the integration of these coastal urban areas with the remote regions in the same countries. So let me come to the conclusions. What does this mean for a policy towards trade and sustainable development? First point is trade facilitation measures have to address the spatial divide. The African Economic Outlook this year underlined the importance of addressing the spatial divide in African countries and better taking into account the relationship between the countryside and the cities. Sustainable development, of course, demands to build on Africa's strength. The changing and very important role of agriculture, local resources, and integrating a rapidly growing workforce into the economies. All this demands for taking into account rural and remote areas and better linking rural regions with the cities. Trade facilitation can play an enormously important role in that regard. I highlighted before that trade costs are especially high within the ECOWAS region. And I said that even against that background, the share of manufactures traded regionally is higher than the share of manufactures in external trade. I think that shows that there is an enormous potential for creating value added and promoting development by reducing trade costs internally within the region. Of course, trade facilitation can also play an important role for expanding external trade and integrating into value chains. Many policy reforms that are also touched on in the WTO agreement are suited to support regional and external trade at the same time. That accounts for easing administrative burdens, for fighting corruption, and for improving the investment climate in general. However, when it comes to infrastructure and services as a part of the trade facilitation agenda, that's trade facilitation in a broader sense, then it might well be necessary to decide on priorities. Which roads shall be built or improved first? Which will be the groups of the society that can benefit from that decision? Will the construction of new roads contribute to integrating rural areas, or will it rather strengthen export routes based on primary commodities? Or is it possible to combine both? There is a danger of a possible tunnel effect of economic corridors. And the danger is that they might wipe out local firms that could be competitive but by adjusting their operations, but are not fully aware of the consequences of the infrastructure investment, and or they are not included in policy decisions. Corridors can, of course, cut trade costs. I don't want to be misunderstood. And they can increase efficiency. But careful planning is required. To pose this question, who is included, who will benefit? And it is important to include relevant stakeholders in such decisions. My second conclusion is that the potential of regional integration shall be tapped. Addressing regional disparities calls to a large extent for regional approaches, common efforts across borders. The point on high regional trade costs and the large potential that internal regional trade bears, especially with regard to creating value added, even makes a stronger point for regional integration. The discussion on trade facilitation demands another look at the regional integration agenda. Trade facilitation in a narrow sense, of course, is very helpful, but also policy issues like government procurement, intellectual property rights, quality infrastructure, or competition can have an enormous impact on regional trade costs. In many cases, it might make sense to work within regional frameworks or to strengthen regional institutions rather than national ones. This demands, of course, well-functioning regional institutions and a clear division of labor between the national and regional level. Regional secretariats are often important drivers of change of regional integration processes. To fulfill that role, they need the necessary mandate and the leeway. My third conclusion is that we need or that this discussion on value chains and trade facilitation also brings, or trade costs, brings us to think about another role for trade policy. The emergence of value chains and decreasing import tariffs led to a situation where other issues play a much greater role in determining competitiveness of a country's exports. competitive exports today also depend on access to competitive imports and to services. And that also demands to really look at what trade policy can do. That's the reason why today almost all bilateral free trade agreements include provisions not only on trade facilitation, but also on other regulatory policy areas. These issues are often referred to as WTO plus, because the WTO does not demand free trade areas to cover these issues. It's above all services liberalization and investment rules, but also intellectual property rights, competition policy, and government procurement are increasingly covered by free trade agreements. The TTIP, you know, the Transatlantic Trade and Partnership, Trade and Investment Partnership that the EU is negotiating with the US is a case in point. Where negotiations on rules and regulation play a much bigger role than negotiations on tariffs. ECOWAS is covering some of these issues in its regional integration process, and that deserves really a look again and what can be done in these areas. Overall, trade facilitation with a view to sustainable regional development and integration of remote areas is not an easy task, but it has a quite high potential, and this potential should be tapped. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Invita. That was a handful, I would say. And so it's the challenge is now up to my distinguished panelists here to help us all digest this. I would like to start off both with Mr. Kola from ECOWAS, but also with our representatives from Senegal and Nigeria, with a combination of questions. Firstly, I would like to ask you, do you agree, or how would you differentiate the statement whether trade facilitation can boost regional integration and stimulate intra-regional trade? That's the hypothesis, and it's probably something many of us would believe in, but I would like us to become more tangible and more concrete. Is that going to happen? What does it take? Do you see it happening in your respective lines of work? And then secondly, and I'll start that with Mr. Kola here, the trade facilitation agreement coming into force requires member states to implement. They have obligations as soon as it's ratified, obviously. What is the role of the ECOWAS Commission? And what is the relationship between national and regional trade facilitation committees, for example, in facilitating this implementation?
Thank you, Anya. Thank you for that. First of all, is trade important? I think all of us gathered here this week believe trade is indeed a driver for economic growth. It offers economic opportunities for people. Producers can offer their goods and services to more customers, and these customers or consumers have wider choices, lower prices, and can access innovative ideas. However, there is a challenge for many of our countries, especially in West Africa, to achieving these gains in trade because the cost of trade remains very high. So high that it detracts or does not allow us to benefit from the bigger global markets. The classic approach to trade facilitation, which is what the trade facilitation agreement is looking at, predominantly focuses on removal of barriers to the movement of goods, mainly around the borders. However, the approach ECOWAS takes is slightly more holistic. We believe that, yes, there are border challenges, but we have to look behind the borders as well, and in particular, looking at value chains to make sure products can move from farm markets all the way to the final consumer. I thank Avita for her numerous mentions on the role of regional organizations such as ECOWAS. Once again, we, as a regional organization, bring together our member states into a larger market. And we believe that by this larger market and that trade facilitation can indeed foster economic development. And I also agree that it's not just purely taken trade facilitation measures, but complementary reforms will have to be taken. So exactly what is ECOWAS doing with its member states on the trade facilitation agreement? ECOWAS itself is not a member of the WTO, but we facilitate our membership to arrive at common positions at the WTO. And in the process of the TF, we've assisted member states in their categorization. Certain member states were more advanced than others, but the Commission was able to assist a number of member states in their categorization. We also support our member states in either creating or strengthening their trade facilitation committees. And we encourage them to ensure that these committees are within a framework or coordinated framework that includes all relevant ministries, departments and agencies, not only government, but also non-state actors, in particular the private sector and civil society. At the regional level as well, we aim to ensure a linkage between what we have as the National Trade Facilitation Committees, as well as a Regional Trade Facilitation Committee. Like we say, we expect both levels to work interactively amongst themselves to ensure coherency and coordination. Countries in the categorization will have highlighted certain activities they would require strengthening their capacity on. In particular, we're talking about the Category C provisions. And our role as well is to ensure that we help them define, identify projects, and seek financing to ensure that they can indeed meet the implementation of these provisions. So in a nutshell, that is what ECOWAS is doing directly on the trade facilitation agreement. But with or without the work ongoing at the WTO, trade facilitation is very important at the regional level. In fact, that is the raison d'etre for our creation. We are here to foster regional integration, and we believe trade is an instrument. We have such schemes such as the ECOWAS Trade Liberalization Scheme, which aims to move products that originate from within the country, from within the region, to move freely across borders. The ECOWAS Trade Liberalization Scheme, the ETLS for short, was set up in order to essentially operationalize our free trade area. And this free trade area, like I said, is just to ensure that we can increase our intra-regional trade. I know Evita mentioned rates of about 10%, which is quite low, although those rates are perhaps underestimated because of the large proportion of informal trade that is not recorded at our borders. But indeed, we are seeking to ensure we have a higher level of intra-regional trade, such as those we have at the European Union level. So perhaps I'll stop here and may contribute a bit later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Colin. 70%, I think, or 60% is the inter-regional trade in the EU. So that's a vision. Thank you for that. Mr. Labaran, also I'd like to ask you, what is your assessment? Can trade facilitation boost regional integration and trade? And also to link it to the trade facilitation agreement, I know that Nigeria, together with Senegal, was among the first countries to notify Category A reforms. I would like to also hear a little bit about how that notification process went and which players and stakeholders were involved in this. And possibly you can also touch on some of the challenges that might still be remaining.
Thank you, Anja. First and foremost, let me reiterate the commitment of Nigeria to the TFA agreement that has just been signed in 2013. Like I said at my introductory remarks, Nigeria has underscored the importance of TF since year 2010, when a task force on trade facilitation was established in Nigeria. Before then, we had what is called a need assessment on TF to get to know exactly what areas of challenges Nigeria is likely to face in the TFA agreement when concluded. I want to thank some development partners like USAID, DFID, and GIZ for being supportive at that process of our TF assessment, need assessment. In 2010, the TF was established with a view to facilitating trade flows facilitating clearance procedure and release of consignment at our various ports, cross-border trade facilitation, the airport and seaport. Our first finding during the trade facilitation visits we made was that many things were not done right. Physical inspection of products that come into this country delays release of consignment, which was of course not good for the system and not good for the business men and the women that are engaged in international trade and regional trade. But in 2013, when the trade facilitation agreement was finally concluded in Bali, the first thing Nigeria did was to mobilize stakeholders that have something to do with trade facilitation. As I speak, we have what is now called the National Committee on Trade Facilitation based on the provision of the TF agreement that such should be established at national level. It's a 25-member committee. We look at the areas of commitment in that agreement, and we agree that about 28% of the measures that need to be implemented should come under Category A. 52% goes to Category B that require just a short transition for us to be able to implement the measures that are in that agreement. Why 20% is that require transition and some technical assistance and capacity building for us to implement? But frankly speaking, Nigeria, for so long, we have what is called the Enhanced National Focal Point on Trade. We believe in consultative forum, we believe in participatory process by bringing all that matters to discuss issue that borders on trade. Our decision to do that was because we believe that government cannot do it alone, the non-state actors, the public sector need to come to a round table and discuss trade matters. And that is how we ended up with 25 members of the National Committee on Trade Facilitation. Nigeria also, 2012, I remember vividly where during Minister Ganga's tenure, we set up what is called the Abuja process. Abuja process aimed at facilitating cross-border trade, where a few West African countries were brought on board. That idea, I think, has the buy-in of the ECOWAS. Today, everything has been transferred to ECOWAS to implement because of their buy-in into the Abuja process. But frankly speaking, the intra-regional trade is indeed very poor because of encumbrances to movement of goods within the region. It's less than 12%, which is indeed very poor. Like Evita said, I think it's not quite encouraging that the regional trading activities are not really where they should be. But let me also correct one impression. Nigeria dominates the ECOWAS trading activities. Many manufacturers you see all over West Africa come from Nigeria, but most of them, of course, unrecorded. Unrecorded. I think all we need to do, there is a need to put in place some basic trade facilitation infrastructure. How could a country, 15 member countries, it's easier to travel from Nigeria to Europe than even going to Senegal sometimes to Cape Verde because of transportation problem. We need to address that. It's very key if we want to really boost intra-regional trade. And that, I believe, the TF agreement, one of the things that need to be done, is also to reduce the number of various checkpoints at our border post. As I speak, in the next 2016 budget, we have a proposal to establish 3 one-spot checkpoints within the ECOWAS corridor between Semeboda and Lagos. In the daytime, sometimes you see almost 30 checkpoints, which is not good for the system. In the night, it may turn to 50 checkpoints. But there is this authority of head of state decision that we should limit checkpoint to minimum of 3 one-spot check, where all the border agencies will be brought together to do inspection at one particular point. And before then, too, the Nigerian government, through its port reforms, reduced the number of agencies at the port to minimum, maximum of 6 or thereabout. Today, the Nigerian Customs Service is equally doing well. Today, they have grown between, they have now moved from a Sikoda Plus Plus to a single window electronic system that reduced human interface in terms of clearance of products. But maybe to conclude, I think we should encourage all members of ECOWAS to establish the National Trade Facilitation Committee. is very important. And to move, I believe, in a bottom-up approach in getting this done. At national level, we should have our Trade Facilitation Committee. Then at the regional level, perhaps, what should happen? The chairs of the various national committee should now constitute the Regional Trade Facilitation Committee with the secretariat domicile in our commission, ECOWAS Commission, to provide all the necessary logistic to get this meeting. But frankly speaking, at national level, the challenges sometimes is found for this committee to be able to carry out the activities. I think I'm happy we have development partners that have been very supportive. Particularly, let me also conclude that DFID has remained a very dependable development partner to Nigeria. Many things have been done with their support. I want to encourage other development partners also to emulate what GIZ have done. DFID, USID have also done their best, but I think we need more of such support. I want to thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Labaran. Madam Diatta, same question basically to you. What is your take on the role of trade facilitation in boosting regional integration and regional trade? And what's your experience in notification process, but also in possibly establishing trade facilitation committees within your country?
Thank you, madam. I would like to say that Senegal is very involved in trade facilitation, and that we didn't wait the trade facilitation agreement to do that, but we start a long time ago. And in 2009, we have an support from World Bank, which helped us to identify our needs in trade facilitation. And since this date, Senegal did many things for facilitating trade, because you know many products of the other countries pass through Senegal. So we improved our procedure with the system guide, which helped people to have information, custom information online. And also we have, in 2011, we had also the system OBUS also to you now the with this system, the private sector can do all of his procedure online. So we dematerialize the document we need. So I want to say that Senegal is very involved on this. So when the trade facilitation was signed, Senegal had a workshop with the parties which is involved on trade facilitation, and we identified the measures and we classified the measure, and we saw that in almost 33 measures, Senegal was conformed with 22. And so we classified these measures as category A. So we had only four measures which were not very conformed, and we were working on these measures. And also we identified 11 measures which we need assistance help to implement and to be conformed with the trade facilitation agreement. And with the support of ITC, we had a consultant who helped us to identify the project we have to make and to be conformed on the implementation of this measure. And I would like that to say that all along this process, we involve the private sector, the custom authorities in Senegal, and we work together and to identify the measure. And also in 2009, we create the Trade Facilitation Committee in Senegal. So it helped us a lot to prepare the Senegal contribution for the negotiation for trade facilitation. And in, I think that it, there is in the 23rd Anomal Practices Observer Report, it noticed that Senegal did significant effort because now it is in Senegal we have 1.3 control posts and 1,600 illegal perception, and for during 100 kilometers you can lose 14 minutes by the do caused by the difficulties procedure. So they are doing some effort for that. And I think that it's very important for us. The trade facilitation is very important because Senegal do 44% of its export revenue in the ECOWAS. And but it doesn't have a significant part in the export, African export in inside intra commerce. So since we can have 44% of our revenue from the ECOWAS countries, it's very important for us to facilitate trade. And by this way, we think that we can improve the level of our revenue. And we know that in the intra-trade, intra-African trade, most of 43% are manufactured product. But when we exchange with the other countries, we have only 14% in intra manufactured trade. So if you need to be industrialized, you need to improve our commerce, intra commerce, and by this, for achieve this objective, we have to facilitate trade between our countries. So I would like to reaffirm that Senegal is very, very involved on this. But the problem we have in this moment is sometimes, even if it isn't a condition for how, for us to ratify or not the trade facilitation agreement. But when we discuss with the private sector and all the civil society in Senegal, they used to tell us in the trade facilitation agreement, it isn't a real obligation to help the LDCs or developed countries to be confirmed. It is because so it is not a real obligation. And we don't know if it is a technical assistance only or technical and financial assistance. So it is important for us to have a good comprehension on this. So we had also ICT support for the project, and now we have the final report of the consultant, and we identified 7 projects which need to be implemented, in particularly one project about the foreign trade portal, because we have the test, but they are not available really on the right place. So we need to have support on this domain to help the sector, private sector, to have the information in the right time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Diatta. I think you gave a very good keyword when you mentioned the ratification process, because that would be my next question. I know that within the ECOWAS region, Niger and Togo have both ratified the trade facilitation agreement, which is might be somewhat astonishing, them being really definitely part of the poorer countries in the region. But obviously, there are issues which aren't clear. There's perhaps not a 100% common understanding, and so maybe that would lead me back to the question: where is the regional national interface? What roles does the national member state level play, both in ratification and in the implementation of the agreement as such? And you already indicated the role that you see for ECOWAS, but what would you, as member state representatives, what role do you see for ECOWAS, the secretary or the different arms of ECOWAS to play in this? And still, I haven't heard much about how do you think this can boost regional integration? The role it can play for boosting trade, yes. But the regional integration part, I would still be more interested in. So I would like to go back to Mr. Labaran, and then also come to you, Mr. Sofa.
Thank you very much. First, let me educate you on how the ratification process, though Nigeria has not ratified, we are almost concluding the process. Immediately, the TF agreement was concluded. Like I said, we need to bring the stakeholder together again to identify which areas or measures should constitute category A, B, and C. But what's required to be notified is the category A commitment. So it is a joint decision of stakeholders on measures, particularly custom takes lead in terms of this trade facilitation. They are the lead agency. We have to agree what measures do they think they can be able to implement immediately after the agreement comes into force. The 28% I told you was what the stakeholder agreed that they will be able to commit. Immediately, the agreement is coming to force. Then the next thing to do is to send a memorandum to the Federal Executive Council by the Minister of Trade. And that, if that memorandum is approved, the next thing will be now to notify the WTO that the process of ratification at national level has been concluded. We have gotten the approval, but I want to reiterate here that we have not actually finalized the ratification process because it has to go to the Minister of Justice that prepared the instrument of ratification. The Justice Ministry has not concluded. The process was on when the then government wind up and we have a new government in place. The new Minister of Justice need to be properly educated on where we are on the ratification process before it can be finalized. On how to boost intra-ECOWAS trade, like I said in my initial intervention, you see, economic integration has a process. It starts from the process of preferential trade arrangement to a free trade agreement to a custom union, common market, and economic union. That is the integration process. Today, as we are, we have to be very frank, at ECOWAS level, I want to believe we are just a custom union. Common market requires freedom of enterprises to establish without any encumbrances, freedom of movement without any hindrances. I want to believe we are heading towards that, but we are not yet there. If this is to be actualized, there is a need to have effective and operational transport linkages that connect all member states. Do we have any railway interconnectivity in West Africa? No. But that is so obtainable in Europe. That's what we should be aspiring to have. To make movement of goods much more easier and faster. As we speak, we do not even have transport connecting all the coastal area within West Africa. We also need that to be able to facilitate trade. I know the initiative of Nexim Bank in Nigeria to come up with a similar process. But three major things are key to connecting member states in terms of trading activities. Transportation, either by road, by rail, or by air. Those are very critical. And within the member state too, like I said, there's a need for easier cross-border trade facilitation. Reducing the encumbrances that traders encounter at border posts when they want to cross other countries to do business all these are important. Whether the WTO trade agreement or not, I believe there is a need for this trade facilitation to be effective within our region. And that is why I'm not, it looks amazing that the TF agreement itself that was rejected in Singapore in 1996 has become the first thing to be ripped in the multilateral trade system since the DDA negotiation. That shows the importance of a TF. Whether at multilateral level or national level or regional level, I believe as a person that TF is very key. And all things that will make that works and properly implemented and made operational should be put into place. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Kula, the question, I think that one question that I think transpires out of that is Mr. Labaran mentioned the infrastructure aspects, which also Vita elaborated on. So is that one of the main hindrances for more inter-regional trade and more in-depth regional integration? And at the same time, the question that still remains in my head is, would the trade facilitation agreement, the multilateral trade facilitation agreement as we have it, does it help in more in-depth regional integration because everyone ends up moving in the same way with the same system or the same systemic requirements, basically? Is that something that would support the integration process? Or is it not so relevant?
Thank you, Anya. Perhaps, first of all, let me address the issue of, you've talked about the ratification. Obviously, it's at the member state level, not at the ECOWAS Commission. But what we do is you've mentioned the need to sensitize, to inform, to raise awareness. And in particular, with the support of one of our partners, the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency, we've been able to work with our member states to build their capacity, in particular, committees, trade-related committees, including trade facilitation committees. So we've been working with all our member states to ensure that not only governments, but civil society, private sector, academia, media are aware of such trade agreements, in particular trade facilitation. Coming onto the issue of infrastructure, obviously infrastructure is key to unlocking the movement of goods and of persons. At the regional level, there are numerous programs and projects that seek to address this. Infrastructure is a priority for the region, and we're not just talking about the traditional road infrastructure, we're talking about rail as well. There are plans underway to prepare rail networks within the region. We're talking about air connections. Many people from West Africa would know the challenges of moving between our countries, and it's easier, like you said, perhaps to go out of the region and come back in. We're talking also about maritime. I think the Director of Trade of Nigeria mentioned the need to further elaborate plans to use the shipping routes because our roads are being overused. So there are other multimodal means of transportation that we need to look at. One of our key or flagship activities on which a lot of people hear about is the Abidjan-Lagos corridor, perhaps the corridor which transports a significant proportion of intra-regional trade. And the member states involved have come together to build a superhighway that will allow the flow of more goods and services using this highway. So member states have realized the importance, and the Commission is there to facilitate and to support the implementation of that. When it comes to, does the TF agreement itself promote regional integration? We believe it does. But like we also said, with or without the trade facilitation agreement, the global one, the region is already working on those issues. But what the additional impetus the agreement brings is that it is now an international binding obligation. So everybody has additional pressure, the governments have additional pressure to implement this international binding agreement. The region itself has numerous decisions on trade facilitation related issues. I think we mentioned earlier on about the removal of obstacles on the roads. There was a decision on that to reduce the number of road checkpoints in ECOWAS member states. There have been protocols on free movement of persons, residents, and establishment. There have been decisions on mutual administrative assistance and also the interstate road transportation. So it is not a lack of policies or regulations, but it's about the implementation and that happens at the member state level. Perhaps at this point I could highlight one particular important initiative, which is the decision on the Regional Road Transport and Transit Facilitation Program. In particular, that looks at establishing joint border posts, and that is where customs agencies in two countries cooperate together in a single building, as it were, to make it easier to transit across borders. So we've been successful in establishing a number of those, and to supplement that, we've also been establishing information units. Trade information is a very critical and important part of trade facilitation, and we believe even though there are many provisions that are applicable at the national level, there are certainly certain activities that the region could take up from a regional perspective to further deepen and foster trade facilitation as an instrument of economic growth. So that's what I want to mention for now, but I believe also the director earlier on mentioned about the various stages of economic integration. Yes, indeed, we are at the customs union after having adopted our common external tariff, which came into effect on the 1st of January 2015. But we're moving towards our common market. We have a number of policies in various sectors that have been harmonized or are being harmonized in agriculture, in education, science and technology, macroeconomic policy. And in fact, we're scheduled at the moment in 2020 to aim for a single currency. So definitely we are one of the leading regional economic communities in West Africa, and we are well on the way towards a real economic and monetary union, which will be for the benefit of our citizens.
Thank you, Mr. Kola. It's very encouraging and inspiring at the same time. Let me move to Mr. Tiller. I would like to hear from you, what role in the view of your ministry does regional trade play? And what role does it play, particularly in strengthening economic growth, food security, and also the integration into global value chains? And what role do you think Germany, or do you see Germany playing with regard to trade facilitation? What's the German approach?
Yeah, maybe starting also a bit with the question on trade facilitation and regional integration. Does trade facilitation foster regional integration? I think it's rather cross-pollination. They foster each other, and that's why we also, to come back to your question, why we also think that both are so extremely important. We've heard a lot about the simplification of border crossings and also these control posts on the road. I mean, this is not just extremely helpful in creating a common market. This is also helpful to reduce red tape. And this is also helpful, let's face it, and let's not be shy to mention it. It's also, it helps to eliminate something which is very prone to corruption. We've made these experiences in Europe during our process of unification of Europe. Certainly, when we created our European Common Market, we observed all these effects, and all these things also happened in Europe. The bigger markets will also provide stronger incentives to increase productive capacities, to build value chains, and to create stronger position in international negotiations, but also to attract additional investors. If the market is larger, if it's easier to move your goods and services in that market, you might be more prone and more inclined to invest in this market. And then the regionalization will also automatically enhance the standardization of products and production, which then, like in an upward spiral again, eases regional trade and finally fosters the participating countries' inclusion in the global value chains. And this is something we've also been very keen on facilitating the integration in global value chains, and also to have certain standards applied. Last year we created a German alliance for the textile sector, where we try to foster also from our demand side, the consumers in Europe, the enhancement of social and ecological standards in the production. This is also extremely important, because the inclusion in the global value chain alone will not lead to inclusive growth and to widespread wealth in the population of a certain country if there's social dumping, and it will hurt people if there's ecological dumping. So we also have to think about this, and trade is one face of the coin, standards are the other face of the coin. What does Germany do? Well, we work with many partner countries through trade-related development cooperation to implement agreements such as the Trade Facilitation Agreement and to realize the potential that these agreements, in addition to the things already happening on the ground, unleash. And specifically the support in the area of trade facilitation, we are targeting the national, the regional, and the global level. On the national level, we support the building of value chain and the reduction of technical trade barriers in various partner countries. On the regional level, we do advise regional organizations like ECOWAS regarding the deepening of the economic integration. And on the global level, we'll learn more about that tomorrow, hopefully, when we launch our global alliance with other donors together. We will also talk about how we can better interconnect the private sector and the partner governments. Because the first thing that is important for our partner governments is to learn what potential investors, what potential trade partners see as the main obstacles for additional trade, for additional investment. And this global alliance is meant to collect these input also from the larger enterprises. They'll also be part of it, but if Siemens comes to any partner country, they'll always have the opportunity to have a meeting with the trade minister. They are large enough, but the SMEs, they will not have this opportunity, at least not everywhere, not always. So if we collect the advice from these SMEs and from all the enterprises and channel this through the global alliance, into the dialogue we are leading with our partner countries and with the regional organizations to then better define what we can undertake together in our development cooperation to help removing these obstacles, then I think we can make a large step forward. So these three levels are, I think, equally important to us, national level, regional level, and global level. And the overarching objective will always be for us to reduce worldwide poverty. We are a development cooperation ministry. We're not a trade ministry. We are not first and foremost looking into our enterprises, enhancing their profit, but to really assist our partner countries. And I was very happy to learn from you, Mr. Labaran, that you are quite content with the work our implementing agencies, GIZ, is doing in order to implement the programs that are financed by the German government and the German public. So I think we probably are on a good track there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ziller. And you gave a few keywords here which I'd like to pick up on. I happen to know that we have at least two private sector representatives in the room who I'd like to bring into the play to understand a bit more what's your point of view and what do you see as the most significant barriers in this case in the field of in ECOWAS, and what would your expectations towards the Trade Facilitation Agreement be? What are measures with the highest potential to actually reap some benefits to ease trade and to reduce costs of trade? Now I'm looking in the direction of Mr. Folorunchu, I think, from Nigeria, but also we have a colleague here from Sierra Leone who might be able to answer. So if I could hand the microphone on to you to give us some your insights. Over there behind, yeah, it's coming.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to also seize this opportunity to also appreciate all the panelists and the distinguished listeners. For us in Manufacturers Association of Nigeria, we want to first of all show our appreciation to ECOWAS, because we find out that the CET, the way it is now, if well implemented, it's going to improve trade facilitation in West Africa. We believe that. And going by the way it is, Nigeria has are faithfully implementing the CET. And from all indication and from information, Nigeria is the only country that has implemented the CET and with no revenue loss. But in our association, what I can put down as agenda for ECOWAS is the fact that, which Mr. Labaran has stressed very well, is the issue of infrastructure. Movement within the ECOWAS is a very serious hindrance to trade. In Nigeria, you have a lot of manufacturing activity in Nigeria, in virtually all the sectors. And you have in some of the sector overcapacity, where some of these trade or some of the products outgrow the national consumption. But how do you take them out, even to the region? That's another problem. And the main obstacle is the infrastructure. Within the coastal region, like he said, there is need for a kind of what we can call, a coastal movement, where we should have an efficient marine services. Apart from this, I will also put on the agenda of ECOWAS the need to conduct a study on informal trade, because it is, if we are saying trade facilitation, trade is going on in West Africa, there is a lot of informal trade that is going on. And then from here, we can draw analogy on how we can use that as also a barometer to improve the trade facilitation within the countries. Lastly, I think the other issue that I want to also state is the fact that for us in our association, there is a platform for the SMEs, and also there is a platform which also look at infrastructure. There are issues that have been raised, which the association has also put forward, of which we also intend to, as time goes on, as Mr. Labaran said, when we have the vocal point, is some of the things that we put on the table to assist in coming to terms with what will be a national strategy for trade facilitation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I must say I'm very pleased to be here today, because perhaps 3 or 4 months ago, the government of Kenya might not have allowed people from Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea to enter into Kenya. I'm saying this on behalf of my colleague, that is Franklin. Where is Franklin? I think he's moved to another station. Anyway, I was very inspired by the opening statements of Dominic Zilla, and he said, we need to move from rhetoric to action. Now, I'll focus on my country, Sierra Leone, and perhaps refer to the Mano River Union, which we are part of. That's Guinea, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and the Ivory Coast. Now, in our case, in the case of trade facilitation, the panelists have said it all. But in the case of Sierra Leone, a lot has to be done. What we need is sensitization. What is trade facilitation? Quite honestly, the private sector, even within the public sector, people do not know what trade facilitation is all about. Before the trade facilitation agreement in Bali 2 years back, various aspects of or measures of trade facilitation were being implemented piecemeal in Sierra Leone, but not under the framework of trade facilitation per se. Now the avenue has arisen or has been laid out for a coordinated approach to trade facilitation. Unfortunately, it is being driven by the public sector. And we know what the public sector is in our countries. Most times, they are not really interested in some of these measures. And unfortunately for us, unlike countries like Nigeria, Ghana, and the Ivory Coast, these countries have very vibrant private sectors. And for trade facilitation to proceed smoothly within the framework of ECOWAS, there has to be a strong partnership between the public sector, the private sector, and civil society. There has to be strong awareness raising and strong advocacy. Because I tell you, in my country, a trade facilitation committee has met. We've met twice. We participated in training. That's where it stopped. Okay? So even some of the members of the trade facilitation committee, which was, there was broad representation, but they did not understand what TF was all about. I'm sure it's a different scenario in the UMOA countries, but this is the situation in Sierra Leone, and I dare say it's the same situation in Liberia. Now, my colleague spoke about informal trading sector. Again, the views of the informal sector who actually participate in cross-border trade has to be recognized. Most times at this fora, we are concentrating on the organized private sector. Again, if I refer to my country, Sierra Leone, the organized private sector is very weak. But when you talk about cross-border trading, okay, it is the informal sector that participates in this trading. So they have to be brought on board. They have to be recognized. So again, Kola, this is some homework for you at ECOWAS. You have perhaps with, I don't know, I'm not sure about other countries, with Sierra Leone, perhaps you have to reorganize your strategy to ensure that trade facilitation actually kicks off. It's not just a question of reports being given to ECOWAS Secretariat. The Trade Facilitation Committee has met. They have done so. No. You understand? Let's apply some results-based management approach to this whole thing. What has changed? What are the results of a TF committee meeting? What are the measures? Where is it changing the process of trade facilitation in a country like Sierra Leone? I stop here for now.
Thank you very much, sir. I see hands there. I'm afraid I also have to keep an eye on the clock, which is moving very fast, and I see so many hands. What are we going to do? Okay, let me take, can you make it very, very short? I'll only take you if you promise to make it very short, and then I will give the word to Evita and with one more question to you, and then the panelists will get a chance to respond to the issues raised in one go. I have two hands there. I saw you and you, but you have to promise to make it short. Two sentences max, or I'll cut you. Could you? I don't know which one. The gentleman on the far side. He's got the mic. Ah, yes, please.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'll be very, very brief. I think the starting point. Let me first say that I will speak from the insight of being the former head of ECOWAS DEX in the Ministry of Trade Nigeria, and from my experience from the Caribbean, because I work with the Caribbean. Now, the starting point is for ECOWAS to determine whether they will have a short or long-term vision for trade facilitation. That decision must be taken because it will influence the activities or approach to it. Secondly, it is important because what we are seeing now is national approach to trade facilitation. There's need for regional approach. Until a decision is taken that a regional approach will enhance regional integration, where ECOWAS will be missing the point, and that is exactly what I'm seeing on ground. Now, let me just say briefly what we have done in the Caribbean. We recognize the ABC, like we all know. Most countries in Caribbean have notified A, but not all have finalized B and C. So what we did in the CARICOM is to give support to each one of them to complete their B and C. We took this to the ministers, quoted the Council of Trade and Economic Development Ministers. And, hello? Yes. So we approached the WTO, and the WTO is giving us support, firstly, to develop the regional approach. And the regional approach will take cognizance of the policies that are already on ground. For ECOWAS, we have some documentation on informal trade, which we have submitted to them. You pick the trade-related facility there, and things like that. It will go around like that. Finally, with the support of WTO, we are planning a regional coordination meeting on trade facilitation in October this year. We established the regional task force to give a connection between the region and the national.
Okay, thank you very much. Sorry, it's not going to work for all of us. I saw a hand, your hand here. I'm very sorry, I cannot take all the hands. The gentleman in the front. Because we're going to be thrown out of the room by Simon, I think, otherwise.
Thank you. Milker Monteiro from Cabo Verde. I'd like to thank you all for your intervention. I agree with all, but I just want to add one more layer. It's about strategy. I don't think the region, we have a clear strategy for the role each country should have in a regional value chain in order to fulfill the opportunities we have to access preferential markets. And I have one question to the fellow researcher. I would like to ask you, I wonder if the mega regional agreements that it's been taking place, if the regional communities, if we are not losing political space to decide our own strategy, if the ECOWAS community project is not becoming outdated in front of these new agreements. Thank you.
Sorry, I'm sorry, it won't work with more questions. I need to, I want to enter the, yes, it's a pity, I know, but we only have 90 minutes. And I would like to give the panelists, obviously, a chance to say a final word and respond to some of the issues that were raised by the other panelists and by the floor. And I'd like to head off with Evita, and obviously you were just given a question, but I would like to add one which I would have liked to ask in more detail, but just to maybe briefly touch on it, the role of monitoring. I think it was also came up from the gentleman on the floor from the private sector. What's the role of monitoring, and what institutional setup could be envisaged to make that happen?
Yeah, I think the starting point is implementation. An agreement is only an agreement, and that's paper, and nothing happens. But what is really important is, and it has been mentioned, information and awareness, and the link between the governments and the private sector. By the way, I just want to point out, because I think it's very interesting, the EU, in its new trade strategy that has been published in October, for the first time ever, included into the strategy a chapter on trade information, on implementation, because so far implementation was something that is coming naturally, but it is not. And what you asked for with regard to monitoring is exactly that, to have a look at what happens actually after an agreement is in place. And the important thing is there, really, again, to include all stakeholders, because very often it has been mentioned the informal trade, but also in remote areas, agricultural producers, etc. Many groups or some groups of the society don't have the loud voice. So this is a very important point to try to include all those affected and really somehow involved in the system. And that is something that has to be integrated in monitoring. A system needs to be set up that really looks at what has happened, what is due to be done, what is happening actually, and very important, what is the effect on the people.
Thank you, Vita. Madame Diatta, I'd like to give you a chance to then respond to all you've heard and maybe come up with some concluding remarks. All in one.
I don't know if I can answer to some preoccupation, I don't know, but I think that I go through my conclusion. And I want to say that trade facilitation is very important, because when we take the example of Senegal, you know, to leave Dakar to join Casamance, for example, you have two choices, to pass through Gambia or to pass through Tambacounda. When you choose to pass through Gambia, you have only 400 kilometers to do. But when you pass through Tambakunda, you have 800 kilometers to do. So it's preferable to pass through Gambia. But the problem is when you pass through Gambia, you spend many time by crossing the Gambia territory, because you have to take ferry, and the truck can spend easily at least 2 days there. So it increases the product price in the south of Senegal. So I think that the ECOWAS have a project to facilitate building a bridge between Senegal and Gambia to cover with this problem. And so by this way, it's important. Trade facilitation can help a lot. And also, I would like to say that trade facilitation is important for our countries to be integrated the international trade, because when you trade each other, we develop our capacity before going to confront with a international firm which are more competitive, and also with value chains. Mr. Kola said a moment ago that we in ECOWAS we have 300 more than 300 consumers. So, and it is, I think that it's an interesting market for the firm. And many of the countries have a good education and can be help for the firm which would like to delocalize their industries there. So by this way, we can help and we can integrate the value chain and can have more in the international trade. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Diatta. Mr. Labaran.
Thank you. Just two quick ones. I think as a concluding remarks, what I would like to say that for countries that have established their National Trade Facilitation Committee, such committee should be made effective and operational. The government of such countries should make sure the National Trade Facilitation Committee are well-funded to enable them to carry out their activities. For ECOWAS, after assisting countries that are yet to establish their National Trade Facilitation Committee, I think the next thing to do is to have a regional trade facilitation committee that has membership across the stakeholders, the private sector, the civil society, and the public sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anya, and thank you for all your questions. I'll just respond very quickly and then some concluding remarks. Just to inform you that there have been informal trade studies, and from that, we've also designed a series of activities. So we even have an informal trade program to implement. Sensitization on trade facilitation is very clear, and we do agree with you, Sierra Leone, that it has to go beyond just one or two meetings. It has to be a continuous effort, and it has to go beyond government, because who trades? It's not government, it's the private sector. So we'll continue to partner with you to ensure that we ensure that private sector are an integral part of the process in Sierra Leone. On trade facilitation, vision within the region. Definitely, I believe we do have a long-term vision. One of our first protocols was protocols on free movement on goods and people. So the vision is there, and we've designed within various frameworks with the European Union, with USAID, various programs to tackle trade facilitation, be it on the trade side or on the transport side. On regional value chains, I agree with you that perhaps it has not been very clear at the regional level how we can find expertise in various sectors. But I would like to say that on the agricultural side, there are several value chains that have been launched. And even on the industrial side as well, regional programs have been developed to see how we can cluster and maximize the various the competitive advantages within the region. So in closing, what can I say? Trade unlocks opportunities not only for producers, but also for consumers. The Trade Facilitation Agreement promotes and accelerates regional initiatives such as the ECOWAS Trade Liberalization Scheme, customs modernization, and also infrastructure development. Because we take a holistic approach on trade facilitation at ECOWAS, beyond just at the border, but also looking at behind the border issues. And infrastructure is very key, and we have programs in place for that. But not just infrastructure, we also believe in energy. End of the day, we want to trade, and we need energy to trade. So priorities for the region, beyond just the classical view of trade facilitation, customs modernization, is infrastructure and energy. And my final note is just to thank, in particular, some of our key sponsors or our key partners, the Swedish International Development Agency, and of course, GIZ, who have been solidly behind ECOWAS for a number of years, and will continue to look forward to both their technical and their financial cooperation. Thank you.
Yeah, again, I'm happy that our implementing agency receives the credit, which probably is partly also due to the German government. No, but let me just tell you, I was the German chief negotiator on the Addis agenda, and I would have loved lots of these people joining us here who were in the room in New York and in Addis, because we had such a lot of discussions on whether financing for development should also comprise private finance and whether financing for development should also comprise trade. Because there were quite a few people around who said, no, this is about ODA and nothing but ODA. And we all know, and today was one other proof for that, we all know that ODA is crucial, ODA is important, but ODA alone will not do the job. We need trade, we need private investment. Our job as development cooperation agencies, be it implementing agency GIZ, be it the ministry, certainly is to create the win-win situations. So to avoid situations where turbo-capitalistic enterprises will just go for benefit and where our partner countries will not really benefit from that. And there are lots of win-win situations, lots of win-win stories which can be created, especially in the trade area. And I'm not a big trade specialist. I came here today mostly to learn. And I've learned a lot thanks to my fellow panelists, so big thank you to you. And that I learned a lot was also due to an excellent moderation. So thank you also to the moderator. And thank you to all of you for being here, listening to us, also to the non-expert. And I hope that if we continue our cooperation, if we continue to work on making trade facilitation a success story, on making regional integration a success story, and on finally also making the Doha round a success story, we'll all be amply rewarded, and we'll have a better living, all of us, also in the industrialized nations. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, and now just leaves me to thank ICTSD and big, excuse me, please, Simon, for extending our time. And please, if you are interested to get more information, we have a stand in the foyer which demonstrates the work we do, not only in the field of trade facilitation, on behalf of the German government as GIZ. Thank you very much. Thank you.